All right, so welcome everybody to my talk. This is to Spark or not to Spark. So Apache Spark, it's big star in the big data community. We're talking about in-memory computations, we're talking about connecting to dozens of different sources, and all of this in a way that's easier to write than Hadoop applications. So it's basically taken over that entire space. But one thing to think about when you're adding a new technology to your stack is it right for your organization? Is this something that will help you access your business use cases more efficiently or make things that weren't possible before possible? So I'm gonna talk a lot about whether or not Spark is right for your organization, and just to give a little background on myself, I'm Russell Spitzer. I've been working at DataStax for over 6 years now, which is a long time, and I specifically have been working with Apache Spark and Cassandra since pretty much the early days. So I've been working with Spark since Apache Spark 0.9, which if you remember those old days is before even Spark Submit as a script even existed, and Cassandra since the days before SQL was a thing. So I have a lot of experience working with both of these systems and working with them together, and I hope to use my experience today to show you what things Spark is really good for when you're working with Cassandra. So to start with, why even consider Spark in the first place? So for me, there's three major use cases that I like to think about when I'm thinking about whether or not Spark is important. So analytics, asking the big questions, asking, how did all of my customers do last year? Not just asking, how did customer A do on their purchase 5 minutes ago? ETL, that's taking your data from one source and moving it to another. We all know that our data is not conveniently provided in the same file format, the same database, the same service, and we need to combine it from multiple different things into one place. So for example, taking your data from MySQL and migrating it into Cassandra is something you can do with Spark. And finally, one of the use cases that I'm going to go over today is streaming. Spark actually also provides a streaming framework. So if you have data coming out of Kafka or Kinesis that you need to deal with in real time, Spark actually comes with a streaming engine which will let you do that as well. So these are three really exciting use cases, and I just want to break down each one of them to think whether or not Spark is the right use case for your organization in that use case, or whether there's another tool that you might want to use instead that would require a little less upkeep. So let's start by talking about Spark for SQL and for analytics. So again, just to motivate this, why do we even care about analytics or Spark SQL? Well, the reason is that Cassandra is a database we know is really great for OLTP lookups. It's great for picking out those tiny pieces of data and answering questions really quickly, but it can't do joins. Suddenly, we might have something where every once in a while we have someone up in business intelligence and they ask us a question. We think the only way to do that is to join these two very large Cassandra tables. Well, Spark has that kind of thing built into it. Other kinds of questions like aggregates, asking to group over all of your data, so like I said, asking about all of your customers, not just one customer. And connecting to tools like Tableau or even Excel, you can use Spark as an integration point for BI. So this is another great use case for Spark. And of course, if you have custom business logic that you need to implement that works with all of your data at once, Spark is a programming platform that would let you write those custom applications. So how do we actually do this on Spark? So Spark exposes a couple different endpoints. And I'm going to emphasize the easiest one first, which is the always-on SQL server. So this is a distribution of the Spark Thrift server, which is an open source product that we package in DataStax Enterprise. So if you don't have DataStax Enterprise, the Spark Thrift server will accomplish basically the same tasks, but it lacks HA availability and automatic Cassandra integrations. But the always-on SQL server provides a JDBC endpoint for any data that Spark can connect to. So that means that if you have a tool that can only talk JDBC, so something like Tableau, and you need to connect it to your Cassandra data, you can use this always-on SQL service as a midpoint so that your Tableau data, your Tableau service can connect to it and access everything that's inside of Cassandra. And the best part about that is that any other service or any other data source that Spark can connect to can be integrated in the exact same way. So you can suddenly have your Tableau not only accessing your Cassandra data, but also accessing data that you have in Parquet files, or data that you have on another database, or even data coming off of a stream or something like that. Now, if you're not interested in JDBC, you're interested in actually programming new applications and getting into the nitty-gritty, there's a couple different languages that are available to access this. So there's data frames and RDDs, which are available in these various languages. But when we're talking about these two things, you'll probably see a lot of documentation that talks about how to work with RDDs. I would avoid that if at all possible right now. Data frames is the more advanced and more comfortable way of actually working with Spark, and I'll go into that in a second. But these languages and these tools are also available through interactive shells and notebooks. So if you're not interested in writing a full application, but you want to interactively start looking at your data, running a few snippets of code, or just develop in pieces rather than writing everything and compiling it, there are shells available to do analytics in Spark, in Scala, in Scala, in Python, and in R. So if you're interested in just working directly with your data without actually publishing an application that runs, you have options. And in addition, there are notebooks. For every single one of these languages that has an interpreter, there is also a notebook tool. So for example, things like Apache Zeppelin, which provide a online-based service that you can basically type in code snippets and save the outputs and combine them and do cool things like that. So just to nail down a little something about RDDs and data frames, I want to show a quick example of the two different APIs and why I prefer data frames strongly over RDDs. So on the left side of the screen here, we have an example of reading from Cassandra using data frames and aggregating on a column called amount. So you'll see up at the top there, we have this kind of little format where we do Spark, read, format, load. And then we have some options that are specific to Cassandra, because you can imagine not every data source has a key space in a table. And this is kind of where you put in a data source specific thing. And then under format, that's where we specify that the thing that we're going to use to read data with Spark for this particular read is going to be Cassandra. And then at the very bottom, we have this really short kind of declarative way of saying that we're looking for an aggregation, and that aggregation is going to be a sum on something called amount. Now, what you'll notice on this, on the left-hand side of the screen, is I never once mentioned a Java object. I never talked about how the data is going to actually come out of Cassandra. I didn't say, oh, it's going to come out as a row object, and you better know that this row object has these special getters and setters, and you have to know that this one gets an int, and this one gets a string, and, you know, God forbid that you choose the wrong getter or setter, and then you'll have real-time errors. You don't have to worry about any of that, because the data frame side of things knows about schema of the underlying data type and uses its own internal conversions and optimizations to do all of that work. So you don't actually have to think about what's being manipulated inside of Spark. And underneath that I showed Spark SQL, which actually compiles down into the exact same thing. So these two code samples on the left are identical. Now, on the right, we have the RDD version. Now, much like my little images down here, RDDs are a much more specific way of describing how your data is going to be manipulated. It has all of the details. It's not a high-level description of what you want. It is a low-level implementation of exactly the kind of functions you want to have run. So in this case, I use Cassandra table, which is another method we provide. But inside of that, I actually have to say that this is a Java object that has a getInt method, and that's how you actually get out amount. So at this point, I've gone from having to know nothing about how the underlying data is actually manipulated to get values out, to actually having to know the specific method. And it's not as simple now as just saying I want the sum of all of this. I actually have to define a lambda, which tells how to do a sum with two integers. So the RDD method is much more closer to the actual implementation of what you're doing, while the data frame method can stay way above the actual implementation details, and you can just describe the kinds of things you want done, and Spark will figure out all of those nitty-gritty details about how do you actually get data out, what's the most efficient way of doing these operations, and all that kind of stuff. So data frames is, in my opinion, far superior than RDDs, and I would definitely recommend using it. So now that we know a little bit about how you can use Spark to do analytics with these two APIs, what are the benefits of using them in the first place? Well, one of the great things about Spark is that both of these APIs basically have a built-in idea of distributed computation. So you're basically working with things and describing your computations as operations on sequences or something like that, But under the hood, Spark is going to take that and distribute the work out to all of your different executors and have the work being done in parallel on a whole lot of different machines. So you get this huge benefit of having many different machines in your cluster, and you can take advantage of the compute power of all of them. In addition, it's really great at distributed reading. Whenever it's interacting with a distributed source, if the implementer of that source did the right thing, it's going to actually take the data in a very efficient way. Instead of pulling all of your data down to a single machine to do your processing, each of the individual executors is able to take out small chunks of data at a time and work on them individually. So you don't end up with a lot of issues that you might have if you're working with a single machine system that needs to pull all of the data down to the local hard disk before you do any processing. So this is all pretty exciting. And it leads to the next couple kind of things, which is shuffles and optimizations. So when you do overwhelm the amount of data that can fit on a single machine, Spark has built-in ideas on how to actually shuffle, which is to move your data from one machine to another machine to perform computations that otherwise would have been impossible. So it's got all of this cool stuff. And one of my favorite things about it, though, is that it has great data source compatibility. There are implementers for almost every single database and file type that you can imagine who have written a connector that lets you read data directly into Spark. So a lot of benefits there on connectivity, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. But these are all really great things. If you hear all of this, you're probably thinking, you know, it's really great to jump into Spark right now and use it with whatever it is that, you know, to solve whatever business problems you have that require looking at all your data. But there are some pain points here. So the downsides of working with Spark is that the moment we're working with Spark as another framework, we have to bring that into our organization. We no longer have a simple single application that's running on one machine. We actually have a Spark cluster that we now have to maintain resources for. So now there needs to be someone who's in charge of deciding how will that be provisioned, how will access be given to the various users inside of the business, how will we schedule applications one against another. So there's a lot of difficulty and maintenance around having to involve Spark in your project, not just involving having to learn new APIs and new ways of working with your data. The other thing about Spark and analytics is that all of its analytics methods are focused on really big questions. And because of that, there's a cost involved with working with very small data sets, because it does all of the work which is required to deal with a big data set, even when you're working with a very small one. So even when it makes sense to just pull all the data down to one machine, Spark still has to kind of send out a request to another machine, which will pull all the data to that machine and then do the work there and then move it back. So you end up adding in these costs, which otherwise might not be necessary for certain applications. So what other options are there if I'm not going to use Spark and I run into one of these situations? So if you have lots of data, there are a bunch of other big data tools that you might be interested in, and I really would only recommend these if your company is already using these other tools in-house, because one thing that I would strongly recommend against is that if you have another system already set up with provisioning and internal expertise, it probably makes sense to stick to that tool rather than moving to Spark. So even if you do have, you know, an in-house Hadoop cluster that is getting old and you don't want to write MapReduce code, it might make sense to stick with that just because you already have a lot of expertise in the organization. Of course, this may weigh against the benefits that Spark has, and you might want to use Spark instead. Another thing to think about is that, as we've learned at this conference, data modeling is very important. And in some cases, you might just be able to remodel your Cassandra data in a way that you can answer the questions that you are trying to answer with Spark using full scans by having the data reorganized so that you have a different partition key or different clustering key set up. So those are two options when you're trying to look at big data questions. But when you're looking at small data, there's a lot of other options. So for example, there's a lot of single machine libraries that treat Java collections like SQL. So if you're really just looking to do SQL on like a single partition's worth of Cassandra data, it might make sense to look in libraries like that, where you can just download a single partition's worth of data and then run your Java application with a specialized library that does SQL just on that collection. And then, of course, doing local R, Python, or other scripting is always a useful way of working on small sets of data. There are some pretty fun examples. So, for example, I like to point out this blog post over here on the left. Command line tools can be 235 times faster than your Hadoop cluster by Adam Drake, which you can feel free to look up. which basically goes over the idea that there is a cost in actually serializing things out and doing these whole distributed computations, which you can completely avoid if you just use local tools. So if you're only working with a gigabyte of data, maybe it doesn't make sense to actually split it out into 60 megabyte chunks and send it to 100 different machines when an awk script could have been done with processing that entire thing before you even got the last packet sent off of the machine. So something to think about that. Within SQL itself, there's actually available aggregations for single partitions. So if you haven't seen this before, you can do simple kind of things like summing and group bys as long as it's within a Cassandra partition. So you can actually accomplish that without going to Spark. And again, just if you were looking at another SQL-based API and you don't have access to Spark, but you do have access to Flink or Presto, you can basically get the same SQL API that you can do in Spark in either of those tools as well. So to answer the question for analytics, whether or not we should be using Spark, I like to ask a couple questions. First is, are we using large amounts of data? Everything we've talked about already basically benefits a large distributed data set. If our data is not large and distributed, maybe we should consider using a different kind of tool. Do we need a JDBC endpoint for a BI tool? Now, in this case, for me, it's almost a no-brainer because Spark provides this in such an easy way and basically satisfies it for every single data source that we might have that doesn't have a natural JDBC endpoint. So if you can say yes to that, I definitely think Spark's a good contender. Is Spark already in your stack? So one of the big cons I was talking about is that if we have to bring in a new framework and we have to bring in new expertise, that's a cost. But if it's already in the organization, then we should probably be leveraging that because Spark can do this really, really well. And then finally, do we have multiple sources or destinations for our analysis? So if we're working with a system that needs to read Parquet files, join them against MySQL, and then compare that to real-time data coming in from Kinesis or something like that, Spark is great because it has connections to all of those different sources and can work with them all in a compatible format, which leads me to my next topic about what is Spark really great for, which is ETL. So if you haven't heard of ETL before, ETL is extract, transform, load. It's about taking data from one place and moving it to another. And why do we care about that? Well, there are tons and tons of different ways that data is produced and represented and stored in our systems. And unfortunately, we have to work with tons of different tools to get our jobs done. And it would be really nice if every single tool that we worked with outputted in the same format or with a compatible API, but that's just not the way it is. But luckily for us, Spark is extremely popular, and every single one of these data sources, as well as about 50 others, all have, you know, custom integrations that have been written into Spark that can all communicate once they've been brought into Spark. So when we're doing this, we're using something called the Data Source API. So this is the data frame-based way of defining how the data comes into Spark. And there are a lot of examples of this. The DataStax Spark Cassandra connector, which is from the example I was showing before. There's ones for Parquet, for CSV, for JSON. And the cool thing about this data source API is that it's available in all of Spark SQL. So anything you can write in Spark SQL as SQL can access any data source that exists. And it's also available in all of the programmatic languages. So if you want to write your code in Scala, Java, Python, I didn't even write R here, but R also has the same bindings. You can use any of this data source code and combine all of these different data sources together. So what does this look like? So I put up two examples here. On the left is reading from Cassandra and writing to Parquet, while on the right is reading from CSV and writing to Cassandra. And the thing that I wanted to point out about these examples is how similar they are. The difference between reading from Cassandra and reading from CSV is just changing that format parameter. I changed the format from Org Apache Spark SQL to format CSV, and all of a sudden my code that used to read out of a Cassandra database now reads a file. And that's the entire code change that is required to switch that around. Now, on the writing side, you see a similar thing. If I want to write to a Parquet file, I just say that my format is Parquet, and I can say my location is anywhere. Here I just said S3. I've just written an application that reads a Cassandra keyspace and publishes it as Parquet files in S3. And it's, you know, about 5 or 6 lines long here. And we could probably make it shorter if I just combine some of these because it's all just one one single expression. And this is really great and really flexible. If I, at any point later, want to switch over to a different technology, all I have to do is switch these formats. If I want to switch my locations to a different place, go from S3 and instead to DSEFS or HDFS, I just switch that. So again, it's a really flexible, really easy API to get started with, which leads to one of the many benefits of working with Spark, which is that because it's extremely popular, these data source connectors exist for everybody. Every single source you want to work with has one of these. The code is very simple to write. As we saw, switching between sources, switching between technologies, is pretty much just cut and paste. And again, the benefits from the analytics carry through here. All of these things will end up being computed and done in a distributed fashion over many machines, if that's what's required. And in addition, it will use all of the optimizations that Spark knows how to do when I'm using these data sources. So it's really exciting. All of this stuff happens automatically. But there are, of course, downsides to taking this approach as well. We have same kind of cons that we had with analytics. If you don't have Spark inside of your organization, if you're not already working with Spark, we have to bring in that expertise. We have to start growing experience around working with Spark, writing Spark applications, and maintaining a Spark environment. The second big con here is that because everything is able to communicate with each other, it all has to communicate within a set of types that are defined by Spark. So this means that there are some types that are exclusive to Cassandra that Spark doesn't actually have a native way of dealing with. So for example, UUID types, which I'm sure all of us are very familiar with and have used all the time, do not have a native encoding inside of Spark SQL. So that means that anytime you use a UUID and would like to use it in Spark SQL, it's actually going to be referred to as a string internally. So you end up getting a bit of an explosion in size that you might not have been expecting. And the last thing to remember is, again, Spark is meant to work with these distributed big data sets, which means that if we're working with something that can only be read from a single machine, the data source probably will not be as efficient. So things that read from a single file are usually not as efficient as something that can read from a distributed file system, which has multiple part files that can all be read separately. So what other options are there if I need to do ETL and Spark is not fitting my use case or sounds like it's going to be a little too much to implement? So the things I would recommend, again, this is in order of probably best to worst, is starting out with the DataStax bulk loader, which is a simple command line tool that runs on a single machine and is optimized for taking a file or set of files and putting them into Cassandra. And it's able to handle some basic file types, and it can do that without having to install a Spark cluster. So it's pretty amazing. A little less robust is SQLSH copy command. So this lets you take CSV files and put them into Cassandra tables, but I would only recommend it for small data use cases. But if you're just testing out your Cassandra installation and want to put, 100,000 rows into your database, this is probably a good thing to use just to test because it doesn't require you to install any additional software or maintain any other additional jars. And then finally, what I wouldn't recommend is writing your own custom app for ETL. You can do this, but there are already so many libraries out there that can do this efficiently that I would definitely recommend working with them instead. People have already figured out a lot of the concurrency issues and data parsing issues and all of that sort of thing already, so I would stick to tools that already exist. So what other options are there? So in here, the DSE bulk example is on the left-hand side of the screen. Basically, all you have to do is supply the parameters on which key space and table you want to put your file into, and it goes off and does a very efficient load into that table. And then on the right-hand side here, we have an example of how to use SQLSH copy, where, again, we're using it in this time to take data out of Cassandra rather than put it in. But basically, we specify our key space and table, we say what the file name we want it to go to is, and we just run our copy. So, should we be using Spark when we want to do ETL? Again, I've got a series of questions that I like to ask. First thing is, do we have to move data between very disparate sources? Are we trying to move data from Parquet files, Avro files, Orc files, Kinesis, also Dynamo, all of these things at once, and we're going to combine it with our Cassandra data? Well, Spark is probably the right place to go then, because it's able to take all of those datas and convert them into a row format that is compatible to work with altogether. So I don't actually have to think about the differences between how, you know, Mongo stores data versus how Cassandra stores data, because it will all come together in a format that I can use. Am I moving lots of data? Again, Spark is a big data system. If I'm moving tons of data from one place to another, and I want to be sure that I have good failure handling, I want to make sure I'm taking use of all of my cluster resources, I want to make sure that when I'm done, I'm sure that everything was copied correctly, Spark has all of that kind of built into it, so I don't have to worry about all those questions when I'm moving big sets of data. And finally, am I working with ETL that's coming from a messaging queue? Because if I'm taking data from a streaming system and putting it into Cassandra or something like that, Spark is really great because Spark also has a streaming API, which leads to my final use case that I'd like to talk about, which is whether or not we should be using Spark if we have a streaming use case. So, why do we care about streaming in the first place? Well, in this world, we have events that happen all the time. You make a purchase, you click on a website, something just happened, and we want to respond to it from our company right now. We want to give the users feedback the moment that they make an interaction with our business. And because of that, we need a system that the moment records come in, we can do something to those records. In addition, we might need to take that incoming data and save it to a system of record somewhere, or we might need to add information from another system before we do something with it. And Spark Streaming can do all of this kind of stuff. Now, how does Spark actually do streaming? Well, Spark uses a microbatch streaming approach, not an event-based streaming approach, although this is in the works, and it has two main APIs that it uses to do this. Now, there's a structured streaming API and a destream streaming-based API. Now, underneath each of those, I've kind of shown that the top one, structured streaming, is data frame based. And from earlier in this talk, you'll remember that I have very strong feelings about which of these two APIs you should be using. You should be using the data frame API. Now, both of these are APIs are microbatch based, and both of them have fault tolerance and checkpointing things built into them, but the data frame API is significantly simpler, for the main reason that it mimics the batch API for data frames almost exactly. Now, that means that this is the translation you have to do to go from a batch program to a streaming program. You'll notice on the right side here, we changed from reading from a Parquet file to reading a stream from Kafka. And all we did is we changed read to read stream. I'm hiding a few details here where you do actually have to set up what your batch window is and some other stuff there. But basically, this is the API change. Everything else in your application can remain exactly the same. So that means if you are doing work, there's some caveats, but everything is going to be basically the same. So if you do a whole lot of things like group buys, aggregations, combining with other data sources, all of that code is still valid. So you can actually prototype your streaming code in batch mode and then translate it to a streaming application with some minor modifications. At the end of the day, when we're changing how we're writing, we just change to write stream. And that's the kind of changes you need to do. So this leads to the major benefits of using Spark for streaming, which is that the structured streaming API that I just showed is extremely easy to use. It almost perfectly mimics the batch API. And it supports all of the data sources that the data frame API supports, pretty much. So that means that you can use the structured streaming API to read from Kafka and write to Cassandra without having to worry about any kind of translation between the two. Now, it's got a whole lot of useful functions built in, as well as all of the Spark ML libraries, which are combined with this, so anything that you could have done to a batch process, machine learning-wise, you can do to a streaming process, machine learning-wise. So, again, extremely useful, fun to work with. Now, the DStream API, just in case you were wondering, is basically the same thing as RDDs for streaming. So you basically get a series of RDDs. You once more have to know exactly what kind of objects are coming into your system, how to manipulate them, and what kind of new objects you're producing at the end. This is the kind of stuff that you don't need to know about in the structured streaming API. So this leads to, again, some of the downsides of using Spark is that, one, there's no SQL API for structured streaming. So if you're interested in Kafka SQL or something like that, you'll have to stick with them. But there is a ticket to introduce this. Everything is microbatch based. Again, for now, there is a lot of work coming on a continuous execution mode, but that also is not completed. And once more, with our previous two cons, we still have the problem of resource management. If we're running a new Spark application, we have no expertise in-house, we have to grow that expertise up from inside of the organization. We have to learn about cluster management and resource management for our streaming applications. This is all stuff we should be taking into consideration when we're working with this. And then, just as a con, I just wanted to note that you should always be thinking about backups and checkpointing, because these are still not trivial even when you're working with structured streaming. So what other options do I have? So if you're already using Kafka, you should definitely think about the DSE Kafka connector. So I'm sure a bunch of customers and other people from DataStax have been talking about this today. It's a way of directly connecting a Kafka topic to a Cassandra table and moving the data there without having to worry about all of this other stuff about Cassandra, all this other stuff about Spark, worrying about resource management, worrying about how to write code in Spark SQL and all of that sort of stuff. And if you actually need low latency, so if you can't stand the microbatch model of doing several chunks of data at a time, you can use a system like Flink or Apex or Storm, which all provide an event-based model for streaming right now. And with those, you can basically get a much, much lower latency than you could using a structured streaming approach in Spark. So I just wanted to show a quick example of how writing the DSE Kafka connector looks. You basically just describe how the data is going to be transformed. You don't actually have to write any code. You just do a declarative description of, what topic you're reading, how the columns map, and to what table it's going to. And that's basically what you need to do to set up the Kafka connector. So should we be using Spark for our streaming application? I like to ask, again, another series of questions. Here I'm going to ask, are we doing a lot of really complicated transformations? Are we taking a lot of custom code that we already have and we're trying to integrate that into our streaming logic? Spark provides a full programmatic interface for us to write whatever code we need to actually accomplish our business goals. Are we joining with other data sources? If we're working with a lot of different databases or a lot of different file formats, again, Spark is a great choice because of all of those data source connectors that can all talk to each other. And then finally, are we using Spark already inside of our system? Again, if we're already using Spark inside of the company, if we already have expertise around Spark, extending it to another use case like this is really easy, especially if we already have that batch expertise, because like I said, the APIs are nearly identical, so we can take that code and change a batch application to a streaming application with minimal modifications. So this brings us to the big question, which is, should we be using Spark or should we not be using Spark? So again, our general cons here are that we're adding a new technology, and new technologies are always a cost for the organization. It's new things to learn, new things to have to manage. And again, it's really best at big distributed work. On the other hand, there are a lot of benefits to working with Spark. It's great for a lot of different use cases. You'll notice the three things we talked about today, general analytics, ETL, Spark's, or streaming, all by themselves would be a great use case and a great way to accomplish things. But we can do all of them together with Spark. We can actually do all of these different things with one platform. So that's really great. And again, it is designed for huge data sets, which I assume, as since you're at a Cassandra conference, you're used to working with extremely large data sets. So it's a great fit for working with Cassandra data in bulk. Again, we can interoperate with everything. We can work with all kinds of different data sources, and we can do all of this in one platform. So my answer to the question of whether you should use Spark or whether you shouldn't use Spark is yes. But of course, more seriously, you should consider the costs and benefits for your particular organization, your particular use cases. And I'm sure that you'll find a lot of information to help you make that decision at DataStax Academy. So if you haven't checked this out, DataStax Academy has tons of free videos and coursework to learn about the integration between Spark and Cassandra. I know I went over a lot of high-level use cases here today, but at DataStax Academy, they actually have walkthroughs step-by-step. How do you code these things? How do you build your applications? How do you actually run Spark? So you can have all of that for free at DataStax Academy. Even better, you can check it out. They have forums and ways of contacting developers directly, and you can actually ask questions, and we'll be around to help you out in your journey to using Spark. So I'd like to thank everyone for coming and listening to me talk, and I hope to see you using these DataStax Academy resources.